Good morning, everybody. How we doing? Good, good. Hey, it is so great to be in the house of the Lord with you today. If you got your Bible, I invite you right now, if you have your Acts journal, to turn to Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3 is where we're going to be today, verses 1 through 11. And before we get started, how about those baptisms this morning? You guys like that? More of that, God? Yeah? Yeah. Amen, amen. Well, while you're turning there, about 9 years ago, when we lived back in Kentucky, I was just after church and I was chit-chatting with a family and we were catching up on life. And we were asking like the usual questions, like, how's life going? How's ministry? How's your job? How's your kids? I was a student pastor back at our last church. And so we're just chit-chatting back and forth. And then the conversation kind of took a turn. They started asking me questions like, hey, how's your health? I'm like, it's good. Last time I went to the doctor, like, 8 years ago or something like that, whatever, you know, I was 25 then. They're like, how's your energy? I'm like, it's good. How's your diet? I'm like, that's one thing we don't have to talk about, you know, Chick-fil-A, Papa John's, Waffle House, you know, Pop-Tarts. They're like, how do you feel in the morning? I'm like, crummy. They're like, I think the two are connected. And they started asking me questions like, hey, do you have any like chronic back pain? Do you have any knee pain? I'm like, yeah, a little back pain every once in a while. And so they said, what if that could be alleviated? What if you could recover faster from working out? What if you could, this is where they sold me, what if you could eat all that food and not have like the crummy feeling in the morning? I'm like, sold, I'm in, like whatever you have to sell me. And so they started telling me about this product called Zizia, how it boosts your immune system, how it can turn food into energy, and how it could have all these health benefits and take away chronic back pain and knee pain. So they're like, you want to try it? And they're like convincing me. Like maybe I'm like convincing you. Some of you guys like, what is this stuff? And so I decided to try it. And guess what? It totally worked. It totally worked. I had more energy. I recovered faster from workouts. And most of all, I could eat all the Chick-fil-A and not feel worse, feel bad in the morning. And then here's what's crazy about all this is that the word started to spread throughout like our church and community, and a lot of people started using it. And then all of a sudden, I would just bump into people, run into people, and they'd share their testimony, how this product had changed their life, how they got healthy again. And in 4 months, no joke, in 4 months, I knew just personally 40 people that were taking this product. All right, well, here's the point. What started out with a small family of life change started to spread throughout our community and church. And in a similar way, what started with 12 ordinary men that Jesus called out to be his disciples, who were empowered by the Holy Spirit, who experienced life change with Jesus, took the gospel message forward, as we've looked in the book of Acts, who were empowered by the Holy Spirit, and it spread throughout the world. And guess what? Here we are today. We're here as a result, as recipients of people taking the gospel forward. And so the last couple of weeks, we've been in our series, the book of Acts, we looked at how the church was first started, how the Holy Spirit just came down and 3,000 people were added. It's incredible. And we looked at what the church was first devoted to. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching, it said. They were devoted to the fellowship of the gathering and in prayer and breaking of bread. And then if you can right now, look at verse 43. It says this, "In awe came upon every soul, and many signs and wonders were being done by the apostles." So this morning, we're gonna look at the first of 14, actually, signs and wonders that are recorded in the book of Acts. We're gonna see how Peter and John come across a lame man and heal him fully and completely and immediately. And so this morning, I have 3 points, but before we get to the first one, let's go ahead and look at our text. So we're in Acts chapter 3. Verses 1, it says this, "Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour." That would be like 3 p.m. for us. "And a man lame from birth was being carried." So here's the picture. Peter and John are headed to the temple in Jerusalem. They're headed to what we would understand as going to church. And this was what all godly Jews did. This is what all devout Jews would do. They would go to the temple. And they would pray 3 times a day. They'd pray at sunrise, they would pray at the afternoon, which is the ninth hour here at 3 p.m., and then they would pray at sunset. And as you can imagine, this would attract a lot of Jews and a lot of people to go to the temple and pray. And Peter and John, being Jews, knew this. They knew that that this would attract a lot of people. And so they capitalized on the opportunity, and they went to the temple to share and to proclaim the gospel news that Jesus, the Messiah, had indeed come. They capitalized on the opportunity to go to where the lost were. And we actually see, we're going to see in a few weeks in Acts chapter 4 and 5, that this temple area became a meeting place where people would bring people to be healed. And then we're going to see also that Peter preaches another sermon and 5,000 people accept the gospel. So this is a heavy trafficked area. And again, Peter and Paul saw the opportunity to reach the lost. And that's my first point this morning of three. If you're taking notes, write this down. Witnesses go to the lost. Witnesses that profess Christ as their Lord and Savior, they go to the lost. We see it here. Peter and John, they take the opportunity. They go to proclaim Jesus to the lost. And here's the truth for us. This is where it matters for us this morning. Is that if you have trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you have called upon the name of Jesus Christ into your life, you and I are called to be witnesses, to go into the world and make disciples. That word go in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, it doesn't mean just go to like Africa. It means as you go about your life, as you go about your day, when you go to work, when you're at home, when you go to the ball games, when you go to school, make disciples. Reach the lost. See and ask God to give you the opportunities to open your eyes to reach the lost. A few weeks ago, my mom and dad and Melissa and I, we were in Utah for just a quick trip. We were there for a three-day race in the national parks. It was honestly just beautiful. We've never been to that part. Like the west of the United States is just like a whole different place, right? If you guys have been to the west, it's just like, it's like, this is the United States? It doesn't look like anything like here. And I began to see the same people like over and over in the race. We'd be running together or we'd be get shuttled to the race. And I always was, for some reason, set next to this man. He's from the South. I'm from the South. So we had like that Southern drawl, you know? And so he couldn't get over how beautiful these national parks were and the scenery. And honestly, it was incredible. And so one day, it was the last day, we're sitting on the bus. It was like a 10-minute drive to go to Horseshoe Bend to run the final leg of the race. And he just like kind of nudged me. He's like, I'm not gonna do that Southern accent. It's terrible. He goes, what do you think about all this? I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, what do you think about all this creation and beauty? You think there's a God? You think someone created it? I'm like, this guy is totally witnessing to me. I'm like, this is awesome. For a second, I've thought, ooh, should I play like devil's advocate and like really test him? I didn't. That the Lord filtered that for me. And so I said, totally, I believe that. And this is what he did. He goes, I love that. Just try and make conversation, testify. You're in, brother. Amen. I'm like, amen. He saw this opportunity. So how can you and I capitalize on opportunities in our life? How can we reach the lost? I have four ideas. First is that we seek people who don't know Jesus. Most of us, we don't have to look very far. We can identify those people in our life that maybe live in our neighborhood, that we work with, we go to school with, students, that we work out with in the gym, daycare, ball games. Maybe you go to a restaurant frequently and you can get to know the waiter or waitress and love and bless them, and maybe find out they don't know the Lord. Or maybe this morning you're like, I don't really know anybody. Well, one prayer that the Lord answers pretty quickly. If you ask the Lord, Lord, open my eyes to people who don't know you. It's like God's like instant prayer. And he'll show you, he'll open your eyes. Seek people who don't know the Lord. So maybe it's helpful this morning. If a name just came to your head, maybe the Spirit's prompting you. Maybe write that down in your notes, that name, and seek that opportunity. Second is pray for people who don't know Jesus. We pray for people who don't know Jesus. We pray that they, as we, have called upon the name of the Lord. We want that hope. We want that joy. We want that peace as we have in our hearts to be in their hearts. And we pray that God will open their hearts, because here's the truth. We don't have the power to save people. Salvation belongs to the Lord. He's the one that opens hearts. He's the one that does that. We don't. We just share the news and we pray. We pray for them by name. We pray for them often, every day. We pray for them on our knees, begging the Lord, would you open so-and-so's heart to the gospel? And also it's helpful that we should also pray for ourselves to be bold, to share the news. Third, we engage those people. We identify, we pray, and we engage those people who don't know Jesus. We love them, we talk to them, we listen to them, we care for them. We invite them into our homes and into our lives. I wanna encourage you this morning with this. This might sting a little bit, but I love you too much not to share the truth. It's not just my calling as a pastor to share the gospel. It's not just my calling as a pastor and as a Christian to share the gospel news. You can do it. You can. You have the same Holy Spirit that I have. You have the same Word of God I have. You have the same community of believers that are in my life, just different people that can encourage you and walk with you. You can do it. If you have a voice inside your head or doubts, that's not the Lord. It's something else. It's the enemy. You can. You can. Fourth, we ultimately want to point them to Jesus. We point them to Jesus. Just like that man that sat right next to me, he was going to eventually get to it, I believe. Point me to Jesus. We witness and we tell. I think it's helpful for some people when they're explaining the gospel to someone to share their own story. Because if you're in Christ, you are a living testimony, a living God at work story that you can share. Here's how Christ has changed my life. Here's how he's given me peace. Here's how he's given me hope. Here's how he's given me joy. Even in the midst of life circumstances, in the storm, he's good, he's faithful. We point people to Jesus. Witnesses go to the lost. Perhaps this morning it'd be just a good reminder that every Sunday that we walk out of this building, we always end by saying, what do we say at the end of our service? We're loved. Maybe helpful if we started to remember this, that we are also being sent. That we are sent on a mission to make disciples. Let's look back in our verse. So Peter and John are heading to the temple, take advantage of the opportunity. And it says this, and a lame man from birth was being carried. And his friends, they laid him daily at this gate of the temple that was called the Beautiful Gate, to ask for alms or money of those who are entering the temple. So simultaneously, as Peter and John are walking to the temple, this lame man, this beggar, was being carried by his friends. It says that they carried him daily, and they put him at this beautiful gate. Now, this lame man, we don't know a ton about him. We don't know his name. We do know from Acts 4:22 that he was over 40, so he was a middle-aged man. And we do know that he was lame or crippled. He couldn't walk from birth. Now just for one second, can we just try to put ourselves in this man's shoes? Can we just try to empathize what he would go through every day? Because it was anything but normal. Anything but normal. Like he never had a day in his life where he woke up out of bed and he could just stand and walk and get ready for the day. Growing up as a kid, all the kids would be running around the streets, playing. He had to sit on the sidelines and watch every day. He never got to engage. He could not walk. He had to watch. He's probably made fun of. He's probably bullied by kids, made fun of because he couldn't walk. Maybe he had a deformity. I don't know. To put it in perspective, maybe for us, he never could just, as he's watching a game, or if he's upstairs, he can never just run down the stairs and grab a quick snack from the fridge or pantry and go back up. He could never just do a quick trip like that. He could never drive. He could never hang out at the Friday night football game with his friends and run up and down the bleachers a million times. he couldn't do that. And if that's not sad enough, in the Greco-Roman world, he would have been considered weak and soft, deformed, an outcast. He never could enter the temple. Never. He never entered the temple. He never got to go through this beautiful day. He had to sit. He had to sit and beg. And devout Jews, it wouldn't be uncommon for them to believe that him or his parents committed an grievous sin, and this is the result of their sin, this illness. This was this man's everyday life. But at least he had friends that would carry him every day to this beautiful gate. I actually have a picture of the beautiful gate of what we think it is. It's right in the center. This beautiful gate got its name due to the material that it was made of. It was made of the best material, Corinthians bronze. And it was called beautiful too because of the attention and the amount of detail that was given to it. The important thing that I want us to know about this gate is that many pious Jews, many devout Jews would enter through this gate because it's beautiful, as you can see, and they'd make their way into the temple on their way to worship and pray to the Lord and offer sacrifices. The beggars would be outside and they would drop their alms and money and silver and gold to the beggars to try to impress God. And another way to put it, they're laying out their righteous deeds. They're laying out their good works to impress God so that God would hear their prayers and answer them in a positive way that they want. This is what they would do. They'd go through this gate. So if you can imagine, all the beggars would capitalize on this. They weren't dumb. They would sit and beg as the pious Jews would go through that gate. And this lame man was an opportunist, apparently. And his friends would bring him here every day. Let's look at verse 3. It says, the lame man, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he probably thought they're just pious Jews going to the temple. He asked them to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze or his attention to him, as did John, and said, look at us. And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. So the lame man, he sees Peter and John coming, sees the opportunity, and he asks them for money. You have any money? However he said, you have any money? And it said, I love this. We're going to unpack this, that Peter and John fixed their gaze upon him. They turned their attention to him. Why is that important? Well, I think it's important because, again, if you think about this man's everyday life, people would just walk past him every day. Sometimes people would throw money into his cup or his hands to try to please God. They really didn't really pay attention to him. They probably never got to know his story. But Peter and John stopped. They gave him one of the most valuable things that we can give people, and that's our time, their attention. It says that they fixed their attention, their gaze on him. They looked him in the eyes and had compassion on this lame man. It reminds me of what Jesus would do in Matthew 9, verses 35 through 36. It says, when Jesus would go through all the cities and villages, teaching and proclaiming the gospel, he would heal every disease and affliction. And it says this, when he saw the crowds, he had what, you know? Compassion. Compassion, for they were harassed and helpless, a sheep without a shepherd. And I firmly believe this is why Peter and John did it. They saw Jesus do that countless times over and over when they walked with him for those 3.5 years. And they do it. This reminds me, one Saturday morning, I was on my way here to the campus. I don't even know what I was doing. I just know I was coming pretty early. And the red light caused me to stop here at just the corner, just right here at our campus. And I saw this homeless man laying on the grass asleep, all covered up. And he had a buggy with a ton of stuff in it. And the grass was wet, it was dewy. And so, and then I look at the campus and I see two men from our campus start walking towards him. And so I pull over and stop and I say hey to the men. And then we go over to wake this homeless man up. And the reason why I'll never forget this is because the two men from our campus, I won't say their names because I don't want to rob them of the reward. they showed compassion and care for this man. They looked at him in the eyes and say, hey, what's your name? What's your situation? How can we help? And they gave him food and water. And then they asked him, do you know the Lord? Do you know Jesus? And then they prayed for him. I'll never forget that morning. Let me ask you this morning, do you have compassion? Do you have compassion for people that don't know Jesus, for the lost? For me, I can be so quick. I can just start running around and I'm saying, hey, hey, hey. And sometimes I just need to remind myself, pause and fix my attention and have compassion on people. Do you? So in response, Peter and John stopped to this lame man, and it says that they fixed their attention upon them. And the lame man's expecting to get money. He looks up to them. He's like, this is great. I don't know, maybe he's thinking jackpot. I don't know, like, you know, he's excited. But check this out. Look in your text. Then Peter says to him, I have no silver or gold. I have nothing to give you. Can we just admit this might have been kind of deflating to the beggar, to the lame man? He's expecting to get something, but didn't it? It's like this week, someone came up to me and they're like, hey, I have something to tell you. I've got great news. I'm like, yeah, what is it? They're like, never mind, I forgot. I'm like, what? That's a letdown. That was really deflating. You ever had someone do that to you? You're like, what the heck? Come on, right? But the beggar's day is about to be made. It's about to be made. Look what Peter says. I have no silver or gold, but what I do, I have to give to you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. I love the exclamation point. Rise up and walk. And they took him by the right hand and they raised him up. Well, I think we all can agree that he got something way better than silver or gold, amen? He got something way better than money. He was completely and immediately healed. Luke doesn't record this because he didn't have to, because it's not how it went down, but there was no crawling. There was no, I got to figure out how to walk. No, it happened in a moment, instantaneously. This lame man for 40 years of his life that could not walk, who could not run, who could not get out of bed and get his day going, was healed. And it was, this is important, it was Jesus through Peter. It was Jesus through Peter. Peter called on the power and the authority of Jesus, and he was healed. I love how one Bible commentator put it. He says, the hands were Peter's, but the power was Christ's. Isn't that a good phrase? That's so true about anything that we do. It's Christ in us and through us, amen? It's not actually us, it's actually Christ in us and through us. And this leads to my second observation this morning from this account, and it's this. Witnesses give what they have. Witnesses, they give what they have. Peter and John, we see it. They gave what they had to give. What'd they give him? They gave him his attention. They gave him, what else did they give him? They gave him the gift of healing. They gave him the gift of healing. They used their gifts and benefits to this man. So let me ask you this morning, what do you have to give? What are you giving to the Lord? What are you giving to the church? What's been given to you? I think we need to identify three ways this morning about what's been given to us. First, so everybody that's a believer has a spiritual gift. You can write that down. Every believer has a spiritual gift. The spiritual gift is something from the Lord to be used for not yourself, but the building up, the admonishment of the church, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12. It's to be used for us. The spiritual gifts that God has given me is to be used for you. Not me, for you, to build you up, to encourage you, to spur you on to do good works. And guess what? If you're a believer, you have one of those too. So first off, I want to ask, do you know what your spiritual gift is? Do you know what that is? We can help you find it. We have a great assessment where you can discover your gift. And if you do know, are you using it? Are you using it? Because here's the thing, is that we need you. We need you. We don't need people sitting on the sidelines. We don't. We need everybody that calls Harvest their home in. We need you. Second, you can give your abilities or talents. What are those in your life? What are you good at? Some of you guys are fantastic and gifted at organization. It's not my gift, but some of you guys, you have it. It's great. Are you good with students? Are you good with kids? You like holding babies? Are you good at music? Are you a people person? Do you love being around people? Can you welcome people? Can you care for people? Can you show hospitality? We need you. Are you good at lawn care and landscaping? We need that. What comes natural to you? What are the abilities that God has given you that you can leverage and use to build his church and to reach the lost? And finally, time. Time. How are you using your time for the Lord, the church, to reach the lost? How are you serving the Lord? How are you serving the Lord right now? Someone told me that if you want to look at a person's priorities in their life, you look at how they spend their money and you see what they spend the most time on. What is that for you? If we were to look at your life, if you were to look at my life, would it say a lot of Jesus, a lot of church, a lot of serving the world, a lot of serving the lost and reaching the lost? Or would it just be me, 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 me? What are you giving to the Lord and his church and the world? Now, I think this account, I think it brings up a really good question that we need to address this morning. Does God heal still today? Does God still perform miracles? Does that happen in our life? Can God still do that? And the answer is yes. He absolutely can. The Bible has not indicated that it has stopped. Does that mean that we should believe everything we see on TV or in the mall? I don't know. I just leave that up to the Lord. Leave it to the Lord. I believe that God still does it. I still believe that he's able. He just can. I have an example. I'll never forget, several years ago, I was in my office and a man came into my office and he brought an MRI scan and he said, "Pastor John, I need you to pray for me. Cancer." I said, "Oh my goodness. Let's pray." So we prayed like James 1 tells us to pray in faith, to pray in boldness, to pray that God is able and can to take away cancer, that he could do it. He could do it like that if he wanted to. 3 days later, the next day, the man comes to my office and I'm thinking, we're gonna pray again. You know, I'm gonna care for him and support him as a Christian brother. He goes, "I don't know what to tell you. It's gone. It's gone. It's completely gone." And the doctors are dumbfounded. They don't know what happened. I said, "I know what happened. That was the Lord. That was the Lord that did the healing." And I absolutely believe that. I saw the scan, right? Like, the Lord is able and he can still do that. But listen, the Bible also doesn't say and prescribe that it happens or that it's promised. It doesn't say that it's promised in every situation. Probably like many of you, I've prayed with dozens of people and families for them to heal the cancer, to heal the sickness, to heal the Alzheimer's. Like, my grandmother just passed and we prayed for 15 years that God would take that away. We pray for those things. We pray in faith, we pray in fervency, and we believe that God can do that. But sometimes God has different plans. Sometimes in his infinite plan and wisdom, chooses not to. And we have to trust. We have to trust. And it's hard. It's heavy. Sometimes God allows the pain and sufferings in our lives so that we can experience him in a way that we never would if everything was amazing and perfect. Sometimes God does it so that we would depend on him like nothing. Sometimes God decides to take someone home to glory. Sometimes it says it's time for them to come home. Can I just tell you something? When that happens, Paul says that's gain. That's incredible. Paul says to live is Christ and to die is what? Gain. Gain. The last couple of funerals that I've been able to attend or perform or be a part of has been faithful followers of Jesus that ran their race well. But God in his infinite wisdom didn't decide to heal them. But let me tell you something. They're not suffering anymore. They're not suffering anymore. They're with the Lord. They're in glory. And they were healed. They were healed. So the answer is yes, God can. Is it promised? No. But we'll pray. We'll pray with faith. It'd also be important to mention this, that these signs and these wonders and these healings that we're going to see today and also in the book of Acts that were performed by the apostles were a special endowment of power that God gave to the apostles to validate or authenticate their ministry as teachers and as messengers. So again, that doesn't mean that it doesn't happen today. It doesn't mean that healings don't happen, but maybe just not as normative as what happened and occurred in Acts. Does that make sense? It's not as normative, but we still believe God can. So this morning, this is my final observation from this text. Witnesses glorify God always. Witnesses glorify God always. Look back at verse 8 and 10. This is the lame man. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk. And entering the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. By the way, has anybody seen that song, like Walking, Leaping, Praising God? Okay, yes. So it's an old kid song about this story. And all the people that would walk by this beggar, here's what it says. They recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. This man was lame his whole life. And now he's walking, he's leaping, he's praising God. It's like Luke described this guy as like a living pogo stick or something. And this man, he doesn't go home. That's not his first thing he does. He doesn't run home and tell his friends and family. He doesn't even, according to scripture, doesn't even like say thanks to Peter and John. But you know what he does? He enters the temple with them. For the first time. He enters the temple for the first time, and what's it say? He's praising God. He's praising God. He's given God all the glory and all the credit. He glorifies him. And even Peter, if you look a couple of verses down in verse 12, Peter says to all the people that are amazed, the onlookers that are blown away, he says, "Why are you looking at us? As if we could do this, or as if we could manufacture such a miracle." Peter's saying, hey, it wasn't me. It wasn't me, it was Christ. It was Jesus through us. Even the apostles, like the lame man, they give God glory and all credit. The worship team can make their way up here. And church, let's let this be a reminder to us, this story, this account, that whatever God does in our lives, whatever he does in us and through us, every baptism, every saved life, every disciple we make, every person that gets into a small group, every relationship and every marriage that is restored, every prayer that's answered, and every prodigal that comes home, we will not take the credit, but we will give God the glory. Amen? It's all to him. It's all unto his name. So as we close this morning, the lame man's account that Luke records, it absolutely was a real account that happened thousands of years ago. But I wanna show us how this is also our story. You see, before Christ, before we knew him, before you knew him, we were the lame man crippled by sin. By sin, we could not do anything. We were helpless. We couldn't save ourselves. We couldn't. We needed a savior. We needed Jesus to come and live the life that we could not live and die the death that we deserved so that we could have a restored relationship with God. So in a way, we are this lame man that have been saved and have been restored and that have been healed by the wounds and scars and stripes of Jesus. It's our story. And so I pray this morning that this account that really happened would light a fire under us as a church to reach the lost in our schools, in our neighborhoods, but also that it would fill us up with more joy and worship in the Lord because what he has done for us. Because he has done great things. And we belong to him. And we want this joy, this hope that is in us to be in other people's hearts too. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for this account that Luke recorded thousands of years later. God, thank you so much for allowing us to be here to allow your Holy Spirit to do a work in us. And I just pray this morning, God, that you would do a work in us and through us, that we would leave these doors as sent disciples and followers of you, Jesus, and that we would look for opportunities to share the good news of the gospel, the greatest news in the world, to those who don't know you. So God, we pray that you would bring people in our lives this week that we can witness to. And give us the strength, give us the words, and fill us up with the Holy Spirit to do this for your glory and your name.